Hello. Hello, good morning, everyone. This is from Overseas Volunteers for Better India.
You need to share.
We had a little technical glitch, but good morning and good evening, wherever you are in the world. We are going to start the second series of this India Education series, the second part. It'll be called East India Company. We have some very good local experts out here who will walk you through a lot of the things. So I'll just give a little brief background about Overseas Volunteers for Better India, and then we can start. Yeah, hi. So Overseas Volunteers for Better India has been created for it's like a couple of years old now. And the vision is to create an India which is socially vibrant, economically advanced, culturally rooted, and politically aware. We need to do that because the society is getting very degraded and the time is of the essence. How you guys can help? You can enroll on our website and help with voter registration. In India, we have a few weeks left all over India where you can have people go and register themselves to vote. We want to increase the number of percentage of people who vote. So we have, you can contact with the local Volunteers for Better India, VBI volunteers in your society, corporations, universities, and encourage people to vote. The scams have been really a lot. India is going through a lot of problems. We need everyone to pitch in and help, whether you are someone residing in India or you are a non-resident in India. And the way you can be part of the change is you can go on the network and you can donate money for all these projects that we are doing. And these are actually the links. In India, we have Vote for a Better India at Gmail, or you can call this number 8888888888 for asking questions on registration, becoming a volunteer. For NRIs, it's the Overseas VBI website. So now I'm going to turn it over to Dinesh. Dinesh, go ahead. He's going to talk about about East India Company. Yeah, Vachela, hello? Vachela, are you there?
Okay, everybody can see my screen?
Yeah, Vachela, can you unmute? Yeah, we cannot hear you yet.
Okay, hello everybody. Can everybody see the screen? East India Company is very critical for all Indians to understand and think. Everybody, after 60 years of independence, have heard about it and they know quite a bit of it, and they're affected by it. At least in their family, going back many generations. So I'm going to talk about East India Company, what is the impact on the world, but specifically more on India and how it is continuing to impact Indians in ways which we don't even realize how it is doing it. Most of the resources for this information is in the open source. You can go to the links, Google links, type in East India Company books, download free download, and it will give you a lot of resources. You can see and go through it and read it. It will take you a dedicated time to read through it, but it is all open and it is available for many decades now. Books in India are available regarding East India Company. Since it is part of the India history as well as the India independence movement, there's a lot of books which are available. Libraries are available around the world. Plus, India libraries are pretty well resourced, stocked with these kind of books. Also, Indian universities have a lot of these books. And then there are search links where you can go in and get a lot of information. There are a lot of archives from British archives. You can get a lot of information which is now coming out. And people have done a lot of research on it and written books on it. Okay, we'll start with the history going back to around 300 or 400 years ago. So when Vasco da Gama came to India in around 1458, around 1500, he saw a big trading nation and trading community around the Indian Ocean and across most of Asia. Okay, some of the largest economy in the world. This was the center of the world in 1500. We're talking about 1500. India was the world's most civilized center of power. India was wealthy from its long existing land and trade route. And the Portuguese had traded. And by 1600, for 100 years, the Portuguese had traded. And the British had to find their way back way to India for the first time with the East India Company. So East India Company was a company started by the British. And when they came in, India was under the Mughal rule around 1600. So a busy network of trade had crisscrossed the Asian seas for centuries. Indian ships and Chinese traded with many islands in the corner. Spice, silk, precious stones, and a lot of items in that period was being traded. Cloves, which were in big demand, it's basically the demand and supply. The demand was in Europe for cloves, nutmeg, peppercorns, and wealthy Europeans were buying it. And the only thing is they had to give up, they had to pay something to buy this. So most of the payment was in either silver or in gold. This is the map of the Dutch East India Company, which started around the same time, maybe a little earlier, but they were there with the Dutch, with the Indonesian islands. And you can see from this, you can see that to India, okay, it was silver was sent to them. From India, they took the cloths, yarn, silk, indigo, and pepper. So similarly for each country, China, for Dutch East India Company, in Indonesia area and from the Arab region, there were items which they were buying to their country, and they were had to sell something, either give silver or other traded items from other continents which were in demand in that place. So Batavia here, if you see Batam, that is where the major trading point was during that time, around 1500, 1600. You can see that is like the center of all the trading points around that region. If you see that the map, the location, the reach to China, reach to India, reach to Arab, all these areas were all, this is like a center point, if you see that. And this was like one of the most busiest market during that time. You see this is the European location where you see what was being imported to Europe and what they had to sell to the rest of the countries. This is the French East India Company where they traded. If you look at this date 1741 to 1751, these were the areas of the trading location. Pondicherry, which is has deep influence with the French, and if you notice that after 1754 there is they were down. Why is that? Because they were defeated by the British in the Seven-Year War. After that, the British East India Company became dominant, and that's the key, and that's the main topic of main discussion in this topic. So basically, in 1700, the Chinese and the Indian economy were each 8 to 9 times larger than the British economy. Not only were the British disappointed that the immense wealth of India and China wasn't flowing into their island, they were also disturbed by the large outflow of silver to their eastern region. If the British couldn't convince the Indians to accept their goods in exchange, the British had to pay for eastern goods. So you see here the map, timeline is very important. If you see 1500, 1600, 1625, 1650, 1675, and 1700, this is the time where they were only traders in the sense that the production was not being done in Europe. Okay, from 1700, they switched their economy and they made sure that the production was in their economy. And they were sourcing materials from India. By 1800, they were trying to get as much material from India so that they could produce in. So this is the period of Industrial Revolution, around 1700 to 1800. That's when they switched over the trade. But they also became dominant in terms of military and in terms of technology. And this is the key to the modernized world at that time. And if you look at the books regarding Western civilization, they talk about intellectual revolution in the Western society starting around 1700. 1650, 1700, 1800. So this is the period when their philosophy and their different various theories in terms of the global world all got developed during that time. If you see the difference from 1500, from the medieval age to the modern age is for the Western society, for the West, whatever we call as the West. That modernization happened between 1600 to 1750. After 1800 or 1850, it's called as a postmodern world. Near the close of Queen Elizabeth's reign, a royal charter was granted in 1600 for East India Company. So East India Company had a board of directors, and it was governed as an independent company as far as what the outside world knew. But it had a charter from the monarchy in England. If you see that around 1608, they reached the Surat. Surat was the center of trading and also financial capital of India at that time. Okay, and that was the capital of financial capital for probably several hundred centuries during the Mughal days and even during pre-Mughal days. And all the financing was done both for East India Company, also financed their money from this center, and also even Mughal. In the history we read that Mughals also financed their armies from that same center. So you see that the merchants are very critical. All the major powers and outside powers who came in had to deal with the merchants first in India. And the merchants were the first point of contact. An agreement was with the merchant. If you see even the British takeover of India, first the East India Company worked with the merchant. The merchants were doing the business, trading with the Indian, British and the Indian merchants were trading. At that time, they could conquer all the different princely states of India. Okay, and the merchants were part of, maybe sometimes part of the deal or probably or either one side or the other side. But if you see that without their cooperation or without their continuing cooperation, nobody would have got inside India. So the directors were the ruling body of the East India Trading Company based in London. Except for the China, they controlled largest population across any part of the world, meaning any government of any country in the world. Code of directors of the company were required to submit all communication regarding civil, military, and revenue matters in India for scrutiny by the British government. That was the fact, which is implicitly saying that the British government were basically controlling the operations of the East India Company. This is one pictorial graph of the Surat around 1670. A lot of these artifacts are there in various museums. London has some of the biggest museum, or India with their discovery of, with their trading and rich history with India over several centuries. So anybody gets a chance to go there can see that. And it's also there in many parts of the world. This is some of the statistics of what East India Company, EIC is a short form for East India Company, and this is the symbol for East India Company on the top right hand corner, which was there for a long time until East India Company was closed. Whatever was when they say close, it says close in terms of this entity, but some variant of East India Company still exists. They were able to dominate in such a manner which was never achieved by any other entity in the world. And they were brutal, they were oppressive, and they had wars across the entire world to come up with the British Empire, where no sun sets in the British Empire. And this could only happen because of the strong military campaign which East India Company did for several centuries. So East India Company is basically the foundation of the roots of capitalism and the modern globalization as we see today. Some of the researchers talk about unlawful trading practices of ship's captain of East India Company to go to different routes and build a relationship and then create different trading relationship and practices. But that is after the fact, you know, since most of it were only British, and British government was hand in hand with the East India Company, they knew what was going on when they were going across the entire world. After the English and the Dutch East India Company were set up, Indian exports were impacted as a direct result. So India was exporting its goods to the rest of the world before the East India Company came in, and they had a uninterrupted trading links to the rest of the world, which included most of Asia, Arab, Africa, and parts of Europe. So in 1602, it was reported about 18 Indian ships a year laden with textile arrived in Aceh, which is Indonesia. But in 1630s, only 3 Indian ships arrived. So basically, this is because of the pirates. So English ships were basically, East India Company were basically pirates initially. Officially, meaning technically, they were pirates. So they could plunder and loot all the goods of Indian trade. And they basically drastically brought down the Indian ships trading with the rest of the world. So then they took over the whole trading route, and then they started dominating the trading. They were only doing the trading, but not the actual manufacturing of the goods and production of the goods in India. So if you see that, they were able to plunder and destroy all the Indian ships and vessels, and also you know, go after any Indian troops or any other Indian princes or any strong Indian confederation could be attacked in the seas, and only in the seas. They would never land in the they would never come down to the land to sign any agreements. They would only go and they would invite the Indian traders and make the agreement in the high seas. This was the practice for a long time. So if you look at it, the private traders, so-called private traders, were working with the East India Company. East India Company was like the infrastructure, having the military power, means, and the ability to control the trade, and they could basically demand demand a price for all the items which they were trading with the rest of the European traders and the countries. So the rogue captains of EAC benefited themselves. That's what the current research talks about it, but basically it is the same East India Company which were doing it. When Mughal Empire and Deccan Sultanate was dominant, they were there from until 1700. After that, after the end of Mughal Empire, around 1707, they started coming into the land, and they got the rights to trade, and they could enter from, if you look at it, from 1700 to 1800, that is a period when India was really free, but at that period, they were able to make their agreements and come inside India and able to put in trade practices and agreements which stifled the Indian economy completely, and that is the beginning of the subjugation of India. In 1650, Shivaji created a naval policy to protect the seafaring merchants from European piracy. The large cargo ships were being easily captured and looted by the European pirates along India's western coast. Shivaji encouraged the building of smaller, more navigable ships to replace the large cargo ships. He liberated many west coast ports with his 200 ship fleet, which he created passageways for merchant ships to travel to Persia, and other places. EIC found weakness in the east coast, so the company of pirates finally found solid ground. So they went to the east coast, because in the west coast Shivaji was able to contain it. So you can see that the west coast was not defeated for at least another century or more than a century. And relatively, you can see the difference even now in terms of eastern side of India and the western side of India. East India Company swiftly surpassed the Dutch and Portuguese, and they became so dominant that they were a nation by itself and ruling over large territories with its own military and administrative apparatus. So you can see that from 1757, when they defeated the French, they had no one to oppose them or compete against them. So EIC is setting a base in India. From Surat, the company could send textiles to the market in Bantam, which is in Indonesia. So the successful industry created an enormous amount of clothes for markets throughout Asia. So if you see that from 1650 to 1750, they basically were the global traders for Indian products. So India actually was the only source of cloth manufacturing in 1700 for the rest of the entire world. So if you see that by 1750, Indian silks, cotton and calicoes made up 60% of all the company sales. From the mid-1600 onwards, EIC began taking control of the areas of the land in India, and to safeguard their new territory, the British government allowed the company to raise its own army. Even though they had their own army, they could now actually create an official army by paying to the local natives, as they called mercenaries, and able to create their own army. The company began to get involved in power politics with the Mughal Empire, and once they defeated Tipu Sultan and the Marathas by 1805, they could then take control of the entire country. And that was the real beginning of the decline of the Indian society, or the Indian economy, which included Indian society as well as Indian sovereignty. So East India Company, a trading company from England, was now responsible for the civil judicial revenue administration, India's richest province, which had 220 million inhabitants at that time. It was a state by itself. With factories, so they were able to build factories for their own production, and they were able to build their own system of logistics and supply chain for their growth. Indians had low level employment. The EIC was able to continue with, accepted the authority of Mughal emperors and did not interfere with the Indian culture and customs, at least to a certain period of time. Then we see that by the time the changes within the East India Company also had changes in the British government. So the British government by that time was getting heavily influenced. If you see that there was a revolution in 1688 within the British government, and then by 1750, by the time the East India Company was dominant, they were able to thwart any British law and became so dominant, they were able to take over the British government in terms of buying out the different stakeholders or different constituency within the British government, and basically became part of the British government. You don't see a much difference between East India Company and British government by late 1700. Okay, so these are not being explicitly discussed completely, and a lot of Indians may not be aware of it. We only see that after 1857, the East India Company was closed, and then the British government took over, which is kind of not really the truth, because British government was really already there. Only thing is, the East India Company as an entity was no longer existing after 1857. So, in 1784, the British government replaced Warren Hastings, and then he brought in, and the new governor brought in, he brought in European style of government, under which Indians were banned from top level of power. If you see the difference, as soon as it became dominant, they were able to replace the system of governance into a British system of governance, and change the power and the people who were in the power positions in such a way that only the English could control. So basically, Indians lost their ability to know what was happening and their ability to control their destiny by that time. Even though the British had not completely subjugated all the entire area of India, which is the larger India at that time, from Afghanistan to Burma area. So by 1800, the Indian legal and education system also started getting inroads by the British and the Western system, which included Christian missionaries, who saw Hinduism as a abominations which were inside the country. So they wanted to change the entire country and the inhabitants in such a way that they were behaving like the British and the Western people. So this is where the real change in Indian society started, and it resulted in 1857, War of Independence. So after the War of Independence, we see that India was now ruled directly by the British Crown, and Queen Victoria would take the title of the Empress of India. Most of the history after 1857 and 1900, most of the Indians know, and that's a part which we can discuss later. But we will talk about East India Company now with some of the other details. So there is a long history going back to 1500, 1600, when East India Company slowly dominated European trading through the ownership of the dominance of the India trade. And that resulted in changes in Europe, where Europe themselves came under heavy influence of the British and the dominant British economy. And that resulted in changes in the European history, which resulted in World War I and World War II. So, you see, this is the photograph of Tipu Sultan being defeated by the British. And this is the symbol of the East India Company. This symbol, you can see it in the Caribbean, Pirates of the Caribbean movie series, where you can see different artifacts of East India Company, and it tries to show a light version of the pirates who were really existing during the 1600s and the 1700s. So this is a map of India in 1757 after the defeat of the French. So the world changed because of East India Company, because of the global trading and the dominance of the economic control they had. India got changed dramatically after 1700 and 1750 and 1800 after the defeat of the Marathas, politically, economically, and also culturally. And what we are now seeing after independence is, after 60 years of independence, is we are going back to 1757, before the British really became dominant in India. So that is our true point before the British really became dominant, 1750. And 1750 is the year really is our real state of India, which Indians probably will be slowly gravitating towards in the next probably 100 years. So what we are seeing is the Western history or the Western dominance of their history, starting from 1500 and 1600, 1700, 1800, and the dominance by 1900, now has stopped. Western history has stopped. Now we are seeing the rise of Asia after 500 years. So the next 100 years is very critical. We'll talk about it in the next topics, which will show you how the global change will affect everybody and the future generation of India. So after 1700, we see dramatic change where British entered inside India to change the Indian system, where India was without the Mughal Empire, and the Marathas were under control, but they were weak in eastern side, so the British could get inside and interfere within the Indian political system. By 1800, with the Macaulay's changes, Indians started rising against the British. The British came up with different ways to tax and also be brutal on Indian society in different ways and control the Indians with the system of rules and laws and with the Indian princes. So from Mughal rule to East India Company, the British were able to change the country in ways which Indians could not understand, comprehend, as well as stop it completely. But if you see the Indian system today, we have preserved most of our ancient knowledge of system, practices, and our way of life as much as possible without much change, even today. So this was the British territory in 1857, and this was the period in the green is the area of revolt against the East India Company, which is the first war of independence for India. So East India Company has a legacy which is very global nowadays. One is the United States, other is India. With the direct involvement in so many different aspects of the world, India, basically East India Company changed the world, but its legacy, what it has left in the rest of the world, is still evolving. So it has not stopped even though East India Company is no longer there. So that's something we need to recognize and then understand that completely and then figure out how we can get back our Indian system back into our India. And that's what the future generations have to understand and learn how to do it. So I want to take a break now for a few minutes and thank OVBI. So OVBI does tremendous work and helpful work for the Indian for India right now, where India needs help and new generation of Indians need help to understand what's going on.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay, hi.
So you can hear it?
Yes, I can hear it. So thank you, Dinesh ji. I just wanted to introduce Dinesh ji. He's an executive in the high-tech industry whose eclectic interests cover global strategy, history, geopolitics, geoeconomics, and study of social engineering. He has authored many articles on these topics and participates in building social media forums on these topics. He's also a member of the Association of Strategic Planning and likes to interact with the business strategic community. We really want to thank Dinesh ji for taking the time to educate the people of Indian origin all over the world. There are various countries where people are joining these hangout series, and I'm sure everyone appreciates all the work these local experts are doing for us. So we'll now introduce people on this series about Overseas Volunteers for Better India. Yeah, hi. Can you see my screen? So Overseas Volunteers for Better India is wanted to just increase the interest and decrease the apathy that people around the world have sometimes for their own motherland. Sometimes the interest is in other countries, because on the outside the other countries seem to be shining more, like if the industries or the materials are better from the other countries. But we really wanted to take these series to increase the love that people have for India. You know, for India has had such a very glorious past, probably the most glorious among all the countries. It is still doing very well, 10th largest GDP, largest democracy, birthplace of the oldest civilization. And in 1700s, I don't know how many people know that India accounted for 23% of the world's income. It's almost as the whole Europe right now. But then through the few hundred years of the British rule, we have really gone down. Even in 1947, we had a dollar equal to 1 rupee, and now it's 65 rupees. So we really need to help fix this problem. A lot of malnourished children. India is a land of extremes. On one hand, you have lots of doctors and engineers, the biggest, the most, the highest number in the world. On the other side, you also have the most number of poor people in the world. So this whole gap, we should try to reduce in our lifetimes. This is a very dense slide, but I'll just say that what are the signs of empathy? Where you have joint family, organic food, you have good social habits and holistic education. And you have, now what has happened is we have this nuclear family. We have these habits which are imposed by the media. We have the junk food that people eat, genetically modified food. So people are watching what they see and then and trying to use that. And much of it is not good for themselves or the society. Even outside people have actually looked upon India very well. It is American philosopher Will Durant, or Mark Twain. And if you see the last 60 years, India could have done much better. Many other countries have transformed themselves. Hey guys, can you mute your phones? Yeah. Like over the last 60 years, for example, like if you look at Poland, it was just in shambles after World War II. The citizens, just based on pictures they had of the cities of Warsaw and all that, rebuilt the entire cities. Look at Japan, where it was after World War II and now where it is. If when people get together and work together, you can actually see the result. When many times when people, there's so much corruption and red tape and people resign themselves, then you can look at the result. And many parts of India are still needing a lot of progress. And these are comments from the Wall Street Journal that, you know, it's very restrictive. And there's a lot of young people coming in. So if we don't do something to increase the work environment, how are we going to be competitive with other countries like China? So Sri Sri Ravi Shankar, along with some other people, we started this Volunteers for Better India last year, last January 2013. And since then, we have this overseas chapter where a lot of people have come together and spending their time for the country. They donate 1 hour a day, you know, like a few hours a week, and can really make a difference. The vision is to make an India which is socially vibrant, economically advanced, culturally rooted, and politically aware. And we really need to go beyond communal differences and bring national issues to the forefront. It is then that, you know, big problems can be solved. And we want to mobilize the citizens. It's you and me who will make this. So we want to raise a few million dollars because you have lots of like projects coming and having members all around the world. And we want to make an impact to the voters that are going out. We want them to educate them, make them aware. So we want to help with the women and farmers. We have 1,000 projects across all sectors of the economy. This is one of the projects. There's this Jal Jagruti. There was a river in Maharashtra which was very dry. And the government and the Art of Living and a lot of people, we worked together and we did in less money than what the government estimated. It's not easy to fix a river. These volunteers for Better India have fixed 4 rivers, 3 in Maharashtra, 1 in Karnataka. So they do this rainforest harvesting, they work with the geologists, they involve the local people, and they preserve the water which would have run away. And this really helps the farmers and helps the crops and the productivity. So such big things can be done when people get together. Here you see on the bottom left, we have these, they go to villages, you have these youth leaders, and they want to reduce the de-addiction. You know, almost 40% of the money can sometimes in the villages go towards alcohol. So how are the women in the family and the children are going to get, you know, educated and become better citizens? So we are trying to reduce this problem. You know, a lot of people know about the issues with women in India, a lot of rapes. So what we are doing here is that trying to empower the women, teach them some martial art techniques, and you know, make them physically and mentally stronger. And in various other cities, you have lots of other projects. You can go on the Volunteers for Better India or the Overseas Volunteers for their getting more information. This is about the Uttarakhand funds. Even the army has applauded the efforts. They're really passionate people. They're doing a great job out there. It's really amazing. And these are some of the other projects out there. We have 40,000 villages. Hundreds and thousands of volunteers are getting together to do all kinds of projects. And it's only through education and creating leaders that we can make such changes. And we also want to have schools of good governance. So right now, the millions of voters in the coming election, the challenges are, we are working with the Election Commission of India to actually help, you know, get people to vote, because many people have not voted. So, you know, we have things like a vote-a-thon in colleges and in societies and companies. We are creating tools for them, so in order for them to vote. We are going to work across so many press scenes all over India. Lots of voters will be voting now for the first time, and we have door-to-door campaign activities. So this is very important, exercising your democratic right. And so these are some of the projects that we have done. So this is a mobile app which we have. It makes it very easy for people to just fill in the information, the Form 6, and so it inspires them to vote. You can upload your photo, proof of address. This is on the PC, the portal. We have worked with NASSCOM and other Code for India partners, so that hundreds and thousands of companies are now having this tool, which was developed by the technology team of Volunteers for Better India and the OVBI chapters, so that people can vote. And now there's a happiness survey. So a lot of people are unhappy, they're resigned, they don't see much hope. So we want to actually see, you know, what is the problems and work with them to see how they can better the India. Whether they want to volunteer their time, are they going to vote? Because we just say, why complain if you are not going to vote? So first thing is exercise your democratic right and create the change. And what NRIs can do around the world, you can become a volunteer, go on the website, call your families and register, make contacts with corporations, high network people, and you know, help with time, talent, and money. The number of scams is just amazing. It's going through the roof, scam after scam. We really need to put an end to this. And the genetically modified food, people are saying it can increase the cancer rate if you don't stop that. So $30 will actually help you to get 100 registrations, $200 for one college vote-a-thon. And for one youth leader, you know, they'll have a motorcycle, their maintenance costs for 1 year. They can work with 5 villages to improve. So only $1,000 can improve 5 villages. Just look at the impact. And the administrative costs are also very low. And the last thing is we want people to really vote and make the change. Because if you actually have a government which is not representative of many people, people are not voting, both sides are not doing anything, and they resign, the problems are staying where they are. Look at the conditions of the roads and infrastructures for such a prosperous country in the past after 60 years of independence. So let's all come together and make a change. So I'm going to that was all about OVBI. We're going to move back to Dinesh to continue with his very informative session. Dinesh, go ahead.
Okay, so I'm going to continue sharing the slide. So everybody can see my screen?
Yes, we can see your screen.
Okay, so let us now talk about current issue with comparing to the East India Company. What was East India Company? It was basically a global trading company, similar to the current multinational corporations which you see today. So multinational corporations basically have copied what East India Company was 100, 200 years ago, 300 years ago. So that's the first thing we need to identify. Second is dominance of the multinational East India Company in terms of what they could trade and the kind of items they were trading and the dominance in that. So the multinationals have similar dominance in the products they are trading in. Then economics, in terms of money and economics, the amount of money which East India Company had compared to the rest of the world, globally entities, it had a tremendous control and the resources of rest of the world. Multinational corporations put together have similar kind of dominance in terms of resources and influence. And that's the key to understand the current global system. One more thing I want to introduce is Bank of England, which is the premier bank of England, which is Britain. And that was formed during the period when East India Company was growing. So there is a connection between Bank of England and East India Company. And the dominance of Bank of England for the pound sterling and building the pound sterling as the global trading system and the commercial and financial capital of London, it is all due to the East India Company and the legacy of the East India Company for 200, 300 years. So the current modern financial system, trading system, global trading, World Trade Organization, all have roots with the East India Company history. And India was a big part of how the East India Company formed their rules and how it built that basis. So we need to understand East India Company much more deeper way and much more than just as part of Indian history or 1857. So that's the key to understand, and people can read this in the open source links in the internet and various books in the library. The concept of third world started during those colonization period. So there are books regarding that. One of the books is Making of the Third World by Mark Davis, which is a very good book. It tells about how East India Company could plunder India and amass the resources across the world. So let's go quickly over the rest of the slides. East India Company flag has similarity to a lot of flags of the current world. It was a symbol of authority and governance. They had flags across different regions of the world. This is the Continental Grand Union flag of United States, U.S., identical to the East India Company, when only 13 states were part of United States at the time of independence of United States. I can see the similarities. This is the East India Company, the Indian coin in India, and they had a symbol of East India Company. And this is how they came in 1839. They had to localize. So they have the symbols of India, Ganesha, Om, Rama, Lakshmana, Lakshmi, as part of their East India coins, which they could use in India for currency trading. And this could replace all the Indian currency, because it was like a country by itself. East India Company symbols, it created a global system. This is the map from 1765 to 1805. You can see the expansion of India in the weakest part of India. So this will tell you how weak it is, and also it will tell you longest presence of India and looting of India, and you can see why these areas are still poor in India. This is the key to understanding the current history of India and the current regions in India. from 1837 to 1815, you can see the same thing. There is a bigger history around it, why they had to come enter India in this region. That's part of the geopolitics we'll cover in the next topics. But you can see again how they had a tough time to conquer Marathas and Punjab for a long time, almost 100 years. But when they did it, they started expanding. And they kept those areas which are very strong, Rajputana. And they made alliances with those areas so that they could continue their expansion and dominate the region geopolitically and economically in such a way that these were smaller states, individually could not challenge East India Company or the British Empire, but together could challenge. So they had to make sure that they were divided, so they could never come together. So this divide and rule policy also, they learned it from India. And that's the key thing. And then geopolitical balance of power is, they could make sure that if Mysore was stronger or Mysore was weaker, Mysore was stronger, then they would work with the enemy of Mysore kingdom, or enemy of Tipu Sultan. French used to support Tipu Sultan to fight against the British. So this kind of thing is called balance of power, which Indians, which the British figured out, that it works and it helps them to control different regions of the world, which is still being used in the world. Okay, we can see it in our own region and in the rest of the world right now. So British Indian, 1860, you had dominance and major areas, and you see that they have reached the Afghanistan border. Punjab and Sindh were taken over, but Kashmir and Balochistan were still under kingdoms. They did not disturb them because they had long-standing, hard fighting armies, and they didn't want to lose too much in trying to. But they, as long as they could come up with an agreement and they don't stop their trading and other activities, they could keep them in their semi-independent states. But they were virtually colonies of British government. This is some of the political map and of a territory. You can see that Afghanistan, they never conquered, but they conquered halfway. There is a reason why they had to go to Afghanistan, because the inroads of Russian Empire into Afghanistan by 1820 and 1850. So they were worried that the Russians would enter the Indian Ocean through this area. So there is a reason why they had to come to India and control India for a long time. But that is their interest. Indians had no interest in the global geopolitics, but because it was in a strategic area and the economy was so big that it attracted all this kind of colonial brutality. So Indians in the future also have to understand this global system to make sure that India is an independent state for forever. This is different areas during their expansion, and you can see that the cities, Calcutta Presidency, Mumbai Presidency, and Chennai Presidency, were the three regions where through which they could control most of India. And this is the geographical point, and there is a geopolitical significance to these areas. So I want to introduce something called as the concept of long view and the short view. So you see this forest, big forest, and then you see the tree. If you focus on the tree, you don't see this big forest looming around it, threatening this small tree. Okay? And if you see the big forest, you may miss out the details within the trees. So most of the Indians, if you look at the period, during the period, they could not see the global changes which were happening. Okay, only around 1850s, Indians figured out that they had to get out of this system of subjugation. And if you look at this, if you focus only on the tree, on the details, you miss out the larger picture. The same thing is happening even now. So Indians have to look at the global system and make sure that India is never into a system where it will get trapped in a subjugated mode. And Indians, because of the large population of 20% of the world population, or 18 to 20% of the world population, can easily take care of itself. It just needs the right vision and the leadership to do it. And that is what the main focus of the topic in this series is. So at the peak, this is what the British Empire was. It is the colonies in America, colonies in Australia, Africa, and India, Indian subcontinent. You see that sun never sets in the British Empire. But this also will tell you what is the geopolitical significance of British expansion. And you see that the New World was conquered. They still remain, Canada still remains a part of British Commonwealth. If you see here, the Russian Empire, which is a large part of Asia, was coming down. By 1700, they had conquered the east, and they were coming down towards the south, near Afghanistan. So the British, along with the East India Company, basically took over India to make sure that they could create a bulwark. And that resulted in the Afghan War in the 20th century, in 1980s, when the Soviet Union, which is the future entity of Russia, came down to Afghanistan. So that current AFPAC problem, which we see, is a legacy of that 100, 200 years of geopolitical rivalry between the British and the Russians, spreading over several centuries. That is a different topic. We'll talk about it next time. So there are several information regarding how East India Company dominance was, but the dominance in terms of the market and understanding how the global world could be controlled with that dominance for several centuries is what we need to understand. So I'm going to show the economic aspects of this change, which East India Company could do. So you see that opium was one of the biggest trading product, which East India Company was growing in India and selling it in China. They could get lots of them and made a tremendous amount of money. Then we had the share of GDP. So the India, which was 30%, 40%, 25%, around 1700 of the world, came down drastically by 1900. And the British economy went up. And you see the negative growth in the last 500 years. And this is now going to change in the next 100 years. And the future of India, our next 1 billion population of India, is going to change it. And the younger population and a hungry population is the key to growth. And that is what we need to look, the positive aspects of the future of India as a strong economy, going back to, we can come back to 1700. Within a short of 20 years or even less than 20 years, we can reach this stage. It's all up to the Indians right now. See, in terms of what East India Company could achieve. East India Company's dominance in opium trade is not even suppressed even now. And the dominance in the global economy, what it could do, is not even suppressed even now. This is how they looked at our geography in different ways. And they looked at and divided and made Indians to think as if they are different people in different regions of the world. And they made sure that India continued even after independence. If you see that Nepal, Pakistan area, all this Burma and all, everybody thinks that they're a different nation. This is all a result of the British way of teaching Indians, and Indians basically started thinking in the British way. And that is something which needs to be taken out of the Indian mind. And this is another map in the late 1800s. And these are the different British costumes and how the Indian troops were inside the British Army as mercenaries initially. And this concept of mercenary, where they could pay large amount of money to get the soldiers and the standing army is critical to look at how India was looked by the British. So basically, British figured out that for a price, Indians can be handled, and for a price and a deal, they could make sure that Indians will agree to almost any terms. Well, the Indians would also get subjugated by themselves. Well, so this is something which we need to understand, how the British looked at Indians. This is the British and the Indian troops within the British Army. These are the different costumes and how the British, look at how the British had to come to make deals with the Indian Rajas. And till that time, they were had to obey the rules of the Indian laws in the 1600 and 1700. Only when the Indians were not strong enough, that's when the British changed their attitude towards the Indians. And this is something will also will change in the future. This is the actually the British soldiers in Lucknow during 1857, where they came in to defeat the Indian uprising. Indian First War of Independence. So they had to take care of the help of Sikh soldiers and other regiments because they had no other choice, but they paid a heavy amount of money to these people to defeat the Indian war. This is the East India Company where the pujaris during the Ayudha Puja, Dasra, they used to do this for every campaign, before every campaign. And you could see that, you know, the East Indian British were almost within the inside the Indian culture within India for several hundred years. So the company was dissolved in 1874, some say in 1858. So that is where we need to understand that it is not really as an entity it is dissolved, but as a concept, as the dominant idea and its dominance over the world trade still exists in terms of UN, United Nations, WTO, and the global commercial market, global currency market, global trading, all are a legacy of East India Company. In the 21st century, it was recreated again by some Indian businessmen, but it's not the same as what it was before. So here what we see, this was came up in 2006. So there is a major rupture in the world right now where one part of the world is going towards the East India Company dominance where they want to have restrictive trade practices, control different nations, okay? But there is a globalization which is going on in different ways and there is a reference to colonial past and dominance and oppression of different countries, poor countries, third world countries, and India is considered in the same stage right now where global multinational corporations can buy out the political system and create a subservient country which will only look after the interests of the multinational corporation. So when Gandhi was asked, what do you think about the Western civilization? This is in 1940s. He said that would be a great idea. Because the concept of the Western civilization is actually was what formed by East India Company and the British part of the East India Company. So this historical Western history and the Western civilization for 500 years from 1500, 1600 to 2000 is actually a legacy of East India Company, but that will not be the same in the next 100 years because that Western history has stopped. And that's where we are at this stage, where the world can go in two directions, either through East India Company in that range or in a more equitable world. And this is what we're going to see in the next 20 years, and Indians will be a major part of it. That is why voting for a strong, stable India, making sure that India is very strong and works for Indian interests and Indian people and the younger generation. Future of the younger generation is within the hands of the younger generation. So we need to create that future for ourselves and we cannot be waiting for other people. That is why your words are very important, and OVBI is doing a great job for it. And this recent cartoon should be kept and seen every day by all the younger generation to understand what will happen to India. So I want to show one more thing regarding multinational corporation and a brand.
Dinesh, you need to click on your slide share or something.
Okay, can you see, anybody can see this? Can see this Indian brand?
Yes, we can see Mysore Sandal Soap.
Yes. So this is an Indian brand, okay?
Yeah.
This is also an Indian brand, Shikekai, right?
Right.
You see this?
Yes.
Okay. This is also an Indian brand. So Indians have to promote Indian brand, not East India Company. So the current East India companies are basically multinational brand. Okay, and if you buy multinational brand, you are basically promoting the interests of the East India Company, the current East India companies. If India has to prosper, the Indian market, only trading with Indian goods for Indian people around the world, is more than $1 trillion. So when you buy Indian products, you're making Indians rich. Okay, and that's the key to the future of India. You can see that these brands are what Indians have to understand. So the multinational corporations of today are using the media and want to change the rest of the world to buy their products. And what India has to do is to, Indians have to understand this and make sure that can we make sure only Indian products is used. We can try. It doesn't mean that we can be successful, but at least we can have one day as Bharatiya Swadeshi Day, okay, where we can, from in the morning, from using our toothpaste and going to the toilet and eating food to the rest of the day, can we do only Indian products? It is possible. That's what I want to give an example now. We can talk about it next time in the other topics, but that is the concept we need to start understanding. And how to make sure that future of India is controlled by Indians, and we can develop the future and how we want to our future to be. And thank you very much.
Thank you, Dineshji. This is very enlightening, and we really learned a lot. The slides and were very informative. It's really nice that you take the time to explain to us. I just had a quick question. If you can briefly answer, and then we can move to Parag. It's quite amazing that the government allowed such a company to flourish in such a big way that takes control of other countries. And then after 1857, it just somehow assumed control of all the operations in a relatively peaceful manner. So if you can touch on that a little bit. It is not clear the line between the government and the company here.
Yeah. So. That is a key part. So that part of history of India, history of East India Company and the British government, there are a lot of articles on that. One best article, several articles are written by Karl Marx himself, okay, around 1850s or 1880s. You read those, you will understand that there is a constant struggle between British government and the East India Company. And East India Company was trying to be controlled, but it is a country by itself. And East India Company actually had a standoff with the British government because of the taxation laws and other things. And several viceroys were actually imprisoned by the, were sentenced by the British government, like Robert Clive. But basically by 1757, by 1800s, actually the East India Company had taken over the British government. That's why we see the dominance of the East India Company thinking process, India East India Company globalization process, and the brutality continuing with the British system even after 1800. And that's the key to understanding where the global worldview of the East India Company became the official policy of the British government.
Oh, okay. Thank you very much. The Swadeshi idea seems very interesting about promoting the products. It's always good to promote something which is nice and organic and something good instead of a lot of chemicals and pesticides.
Indian brands. Indian brands is the key. It is about the Indian brand. Brands are the property of the multinational corporations. This is directly they have copied from the East India Company. Can India create its own India brands worldwide? It is possible. We are 1 billion plus population. We are going to increase more. Can't we do that? Yes, we can do it.
Yes, that's a very, very good point. Thank you, Dineshji. Now, Parag-ji has some slides to talk. Parag-ji, are you there?
Yes, but I don't have any slides. There's a few points that I wanted to make, kind of to complement what Dinesh had said. So, yeah, my video is on. Is that okay?
Yes.
All right. So, I just heard Dinesh mention about Karl Marx had written about the East India Company. Let me just quickly make a quick comment on that. Because that was part of the research that we did for Operation Red Lotus was Karl Marx has supposedly have written 21 articles about the East India Company and how they were oppressing India. The interesting thing is he used to write along with Engels for New York Daily Times and in during that period. However, the articles that he supposedly had written are not available in any archives. The first time any mention of these articles shows up is in 1951 when the editor of Illustrated Weekly of India claimed that, hey, this guy had actually written these articles. First, there were two articles which apparently came from Russia with a claim that they were originally published in New York Daily Tribune. So this went on, and then the number of articles increased to 21. But there is no reference to Karl Marx having written anything in 1857 during that period. Most of these publications were created by communist leaders in India with potentially support from Russia in the 1950s. This was a time in which the narrative of 1857 was reinvented by communist historians within India. So let's be careful before we attribute wisdom to Karl Marx. Okay, so that was just a side. Another thing I wanted to mention was the state of the Indian economy prior to the British control of India. So Dinesh mentioned that India's GDP, and also I think Mehul also mentioned that India's GDP was nearly 25% in the 1700s and over 33% in the 1600s. Even in the early 1800s, Indian manufacturing was reasonably strong. And the process of Indian manufacturing, I had mentioned that last week, is that India is one of the few places where we always had decentralized manufacturing. That means manufacturing was not in hubs in centralized cities, but manufacturing was decentralized, and every manufacturer was an independent owner. So rather than people working as employees or in near like slave-like conditions in factories that the US had or Britain had in the 1700s, in India, the manufacturers, the weavers, were actually independent workers. Now, the negotiating power between the manufacturers and the traders in a pre-East India Company India was very different. So, for example, if you take a snapshot of late 1700s, early 1800s, southern India, where weaving was still strong, the way a process worked was there were plenty of weavers, each operating independently in any village or in any town. A local merchant would have an idea as to what would be the rough demand for a particular type of textile which would be in some area. So they would be dealing with some other trader somewhere else, but they would say that, okay, I need about so many yards or meters of this particular type of cloth because I know there's a demand for it. So they would approach a weaver, one of the weavers, and they would say, okay, I'm going to place an order for so much cloth. Now the weaver, the negotiating power of the weaver was strong. The reason was because there were plenty of these merchants in the village. So the market was relatively open because it was not controlled. The weaver could demand 50% of the price as a deposit. And that would be used towards purchasing the yarn, purchasing the dyes and manufacturing cost. And the remaining 50% was paid or negotiated based on the quality at the end of the delivery. Now, because the markets were free and because there was plenty of competition, the negotiating power was with the manufacturers. However, what happened was that as the East India Company came, instead of having, let's say, 20, 30 merchants in a village who were aggregating the demand, they were replaced by licensees of the East India Company. So instead of 20, 30 independent merchants working with independent weavers, they replaced with one or two East India license holders. Now, this completely twisted the balance negotiating power because now the weavers could not really say that, well, if you're not going to give me so many rupees for my cloth, I can go somewhere else. Now they could no longer do it. So the price itself was negotiated down and the 50% deposit became a 50% loan. So now the merchants, instead of being people who were buying goods and selling them, they actually became lenders. And the only reason why they became lenders, so we were told that, okay, people became lenders, but how did they become lenders? They became lenders because of a monopoly that was exercised through license Raj. It is really understanding that it was the licensing and the control of the government. It was a collusion. East India Company in itself means nothing, really. It's really the collusion with the government which centralizes authority. And that is the key in understanding how power devolves and becomes centralized. One such example is the letter that Jahangir had written to, I'm going to try to read this out. Let me see if I can share my screen. Give me just a moment. Are people able to see what I have here?
Yeah.
Okay. So the East India Company in 1616 or so wanted a license from the Mughal emperor for trading. So he wrote he gave a gift to Jahangir. We don't really know what that gift was, but we have a letter that Jahangir wrote back to Thomas Rowe, who was the representative of the King of England, and they wanted a monopoly on certain ports. So the letter that Jahangir wrote went like this. The letter of love and friendship which you send and the presents, tokens of your good affections towards me, I have received by the hands of your ambassador, Sir Thomas Rowe, delivered to me in an acceptable and happy hour, upon which my eyes were so fixed that I could not easily remove them to any other object, and have accepted them with great joy and delight. So for confirmation of our love and friendship, I desire your majesty to command your merchants to bring in their ships of all sorts of rarities and rich goods fit for my palace, and that you be pleased to send me your royal letters by every opportunity, that I may rejoice in your health and prosperous affairs. So essentially, what Jahangir is talking about is that, well, you gave me a gift, and I expect more gifts in the future, and therefore here I give you a license. So the issue, you're talking about a large corporation making a deal with the emperor through private gifts. This is a form of centralizing authority, and the minute you centralize authority, it means that you can lend it itself to corruption. So the further degradation continued as an alliance between through a license holder, and Bengal was essentially handed over as a monopoly of trade to the British through this centralized authority. So we have to recognize that the way to deal with this is to keep power decentralized, and that was something which was unique to India. So parts of India which remained independent and free, and although there were many states which ruled it, they were able to counter the British rule. The main reason was because there was no centralized authority to give a license to the foreigners. So these were some of the things which I just wanted to compliment. Anything else you want me to talk about? I think Vatsala has a question.
There is one question which I is think there on the question.
So Vatsala, you want me to talk about the famine?
Right? Yes, please.
So if you look at the history of famines in India, droughts used to happen frequently. There were plenty of history of droughts. That means rainfall would go up and down. That rarely, in the 1,000 years from 1,080, the last millennia, there were six famines from 1,080 to about 1700s. But from the late 1700s to the late 1800s, there were 24 famines in just 100 years. And these 24 famines resulted in literally millions of deaths. Now, the question is, how does a drought become a famine? So if you look from 17, there was what's called as the first Bengal famine in 1771. It was actually, this was a time in which the East India Company had taken control of Bengal. And that was a period in which Mahaji Shinde and the Marathas were setting up a new front against the English. So they wanted to take over, evict the, after taking over Delhi, who had given the licenses to the British, the Marathas wanted to take out British from Bengal. So as we talked about in the last presentation, cutting off the enemy supply lines is one way of preventing an invasion. So to prevent a Maratha invasion into Bengal, what the British did was they cut off food to a large number of villagers. So during 2 years, about one third of Bengal was starved to death. 10 million Bengalis actually starved and died in the first Bengal famine. The population of Bengal was about 30 million at that time, and 10 million people died in that famine. And this was a way which essentially completely prevented the Marathas, because essentially if an army is supposed to march into an area, they would need food. And if the local people don't have any food to eat, there's no way you're going to be able to have food competing with the people. So famines we have to understand famines from a context of a military campaign. And the brutality of the British was evident through these controlled military exercises in which millions of people were actually starved to death. The same was repeated in 1857, and then again in 1842 when Subhash Chandra Bose invaded Bengal from Myanmar. Again, the rice was removed from Bengal, and that led to a death of 4 million Bengalis that period as well.
Okay, really nice. There's a question here. I don't know who Dinesh or Paraji wants to answer. Did Indian entrepreneurs help East India Company to survive at a certain stage? Did they keep them in India?
I mean, let me just take a quick thing. Yeah. To call them entrepreneurs is wrong. Licensee holders, the minute you create a policy, for example, if you say that, for example, in China, in Indonesia, none of the local merchants were allowed to have. So the Dutch actually created a policy of giving licenses to merchants. So that means instead of a merchant being a merchant, you had to have a license from the government to operate. And then they said, well, no local person is going to be given the license. We're going to give that license to Chinese merchants. Similarly, in Africa, Indians were given the licenses instead of the Africans. So would you call the Indians who went to Africa as entrepreneurs? Well, potentially. But really, the only way they became entrepreneurs is because it was a British policy to make sure that the locals do not get the licenses and somebody else does. Now, a similar policy was enacted within India, where the local merchants, whoever they were eliminated, and people from other provinces were brought in and given licenses and said that you alone will have the authority to buy and sell these goods. So it was really the license raj which created the so-called entrepreneurs. So to blame it on entrepreneurs, or to really blame people for taking advantage of the licenses that was given to them, would be a secondary question. It's not a question of laying fault. The primary problem is the fact that there were licenses, and it was licenses authorized by the government, which was forced on the people.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Thank you.
I will answer a little bit on that. Apart from the licenses, the other part is the East India Company had to work with the merchants right from 1600, because initially they were just trading. Okay, they had to get the goods, so there was that element. So there was an understanding for a long time, and from that they were able to move forward and then get into the ruling groups and the Maharajas and the different princes, and then come up with trading agreements and then start stifling the Indian whole free market trading system, as well as different rights and liberal trading system which India already always had for centuries. So they basically curtailed our entire freedom of trading system completely. It took them a couple of centuries. India is in the same situation right now in WTO negotiations, where Indians are being put under notice that India has no free trade system and it's not allowing foreign products to come inside India. Something like that is happening. So they are taking advantage of the entire global system to do that. So we need to understand from our past, from our history, to understand how the global system is still working in a similar fashion, which East India Company did it through the experience of India. The same system is there in the World Trade Organization even now, in some form or the other.
Thank you, Dinesh ji. So we just want to introduce the other speaker who had come. So Parag Tope, he is a technology entrepreneur with a passion for reassessing Indian history and decoding Indic wisdom. He has an MBA from the Ross School of Business and a master's in mechanical engineering. He comes from the lineage of Tatya Tope, and Operation Red Lotus is a result of over 3 years of research by the Tope family to reassess the history of 1857 in an Indian context. Operation Red Lotus offers an insight on the Indic triad of freedom and its relevance to the 20th and 21st century. Parag was one of the speakers at the previous seminar also, so which is on YouTube. So at this point, we don't see any other questions. We are going to start wrapping up. So this is what NRIs can actually do in the city. Please become a volunteer in whichever country you are in. You can start your local OVBI chapter. You can call your friends and family in India to do voter registration. There are only a few weeks left, and make sure they all vote. And create your teams and networks in the various corporations, universities you belong to get together and do various projects. OVBI was started in the US, but has moved to various countries like Canada, UK, Japan, all. So more countries can join. The country is in a real dire situation right now with the rupee plunging, GMO problems, border issues, women's problems. Scams are really high. We really need people to get together and be part of a change. Your $30 will help get 100 registrations. $200 will help one college do a voting competition. And $1,000 will help a youth leader with 5 villages. We want to change this, that the UPA came to power with 16% of voters. So we want a government that is more representative of the people, so they can feel more for the whole country. These are the contacts. The website for resident Indians is ivoteforabetterindia.in, and the email is voteforabetterindia@gmail. And for NRIs, overseasvbi.org, we do lots of other events. And these are one of the Google Hangouts for the education of everybody. So as Gandhiji said, be the change you wish to see in the world. Let's all come together and continue with that. So on behalf of Overseas Volunteers for Better India, I wanted to thank you all for attending the Hangout right now, and look forward to the next series. The next series will be about media in India. It'll be at 8 a.m. Pacific. That's 9:30 in India, and 12 p.m. East Coast time. So, namaste, Jai Hind, everybody. Thank you.
Thank you. Namaste.